Good evening, and thank you for joining us on this evening. My name is Oren Liebermann, and I'll be your host for tonight's panel discussion about Jerusalem following this screening. I'm now CNN's Pentagon correspondent, but for most of the past 6 years, I had the privilege of being CNN's Jerusalem correspondent. That 6 years obviously was very significant for my life, and it felt like a long time, but in terms of what we just saw, the history we just witnessed, it is a mere 1/500th of that history. And Jerusalem even predates what we saw here. But of course, we'll focus on what we've seen since King David and where it's gone since then. Thank you for joining us for this screening of the first of 6 episodes of Jerusalem, City of Faith and Fury, produced by Blackfin, that explores the history of the city, its flaws, its wonders, and the conflicts that helped shape and define it, that helped shape and define religion, the people, and of course, world history. Allow me to introduce our panelists for this evening. Professor Michael Brenner, he is the Seymour and Lillian AbensohnChair in Israel Studies at American University in Washington, D.C., and a professor of Jewish history and culture at the University of Munich in Germany. And Professor Suleiman Mourad, a professor of religion at Smith College. They are both prolific authors and experts on the subject matter, on Jerusalem, its importance, its history, and they'll give us even more insight than we saw here in the first episode of Jerusalem, City of Faith and Fury. So, if I may, let's jump right into it, and we'll hear from our panelists as we move forward here. There was one line, and I've seen this episode quite a few times now, that jumped out at me, and I'll use that as a starting point, and we'll build from there. And please, I'd like to hear from both of our panelists. The line was in discussing the Philistines. Their history was written by their enemies. And it struck me as very similar to a line at the beginning of Braveheart, of all things. History is written by those who did the killing. Unfortunately, when we're talking about biblical history, there isn't much to compare it to. What does that mean for us in terms of how we should interpret it, how skeptical we should be? Should we view this all with a grain of salt, or is its importance already etched in stone and it doesn't matter what skepticism or cynicism or questions we have at this point? Professor Brenner. Well,
if I may start, I think you're absolutely right. And not just a grain of salt, but I think a lot of salt. If we go to the biblical history, these are wonderful stories, stories which have a lot of power because they have developed their own power over the century and actually millennia. But to tell the truth, we don't really know what happened. We really don't know much about King David and King Solomon because we have one account, and the one account is the Bible, and there is no other account we can verify it with. And this history was written by the ones who established Jerusalem, who made Jerusalem the center of the kingdom of Judea, of Judah first. And so it is written in a way by those who want to see history in that certain way. And as a historian, and I am a historian of the modern period, I would say, let's be very careful before we regard what we've just seen as facts. These are stories that develop their real power by being told over centuries and by being the foundational literature for the three religions we're discussing today, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam.
Professor Mourad.
Thank you, Oren, for this opportunity. And good evening, Professor Brenner. I completely agree on this point that the history that we are talking about is largely coming to us from the Bible. But that story has gone historically through processes of interpretation in order to add to it meanings. The rabbinic tradition, the Jewish rabbinic tradition has done a lot of that. The Christian tradition has done a lot of that. And the Islamic tradition has done a lot of that in order to explain the exact meanings. So yes, we need to be a little bit humble in the way we approach that history to realize that there is nothing absolute about it, that we have largely one dimension about it, that is the dimension of the Bible. And equally, we need to start listening to other evidence that's starting to come to us, especially, I mean here, archaeology. That's showing actually the ancient Israelites and the Philistines possibly were much, much less than the Bible is reflecting. Recent archaeology, for instance, in Israel are showing that the Philistines' towns are much smaller than the Bible represents them. And there is much more coexistence between the two groups. Yet the Bible is trying to give, as Professor Brenner said, a particular interpretation of that story from a particular point of view. And that became the foundational story for Judaism, Christianity, and Islam.
I'll build on a point you just made. There are theories now and archaeologists that have come forward and essentially questioned what we see in the Bible. Was King David really the king of not an empire, but a kingdom? Or was he essentially a local leader with some villages? There are questions as well about the story of Masada, and certainly questions about other what archaeological evidence exists for other stories in the Bible. Should we listen to these? Could these be true? And more importantly, does it change anything in terms of the importance of the city or the history of the city, if they are, to the people who believe in these stories?
I think, Oren, you said the key issue here is the people who believe. And that is a very important aspect that we need to keep in mind, that a lot of these legends become part of a belief system. And they are part of the belief systems of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. I don't necessarily say that in order to explain what Jews, Christians, and Muslims do, but I say because that's what they draw upon in order to legitimize political, religious, and social choices, especially today. So that narrative, even though it might not actually exist, or even it might be extremely exaggerated, it's exploited today for political, religious, and other purposes. And that's why we need to listen to it. Your point is extremely well taken, in my opinion, that we need to look at other and listen to other evidence in order to become more humble in the way we assert our absolute rights and absolute narrative. That is the problem, is the absolute assertion that what we know through the Bible or through our religious legends is the only truth, which is not the case.
Professor Brenner, when it comes to Jerusalem, is the power of the story more important than the power of the truth?
In a way, yes, because of course, some people are interested in the truth or the facts, as you said before, pointing to some of the archaeologists. But for most people, it is more interesting to think of the myth and of the stories which have been told and retold. And I think, you know, just watching the first part of the series, it is an example how we also contribute to the myth, because we want to show the history as the history of these kings who existed in these grandiose kingdoms, but we really don't know. But if we were to tell that, you know, that would, and I agree very much with Professor Mourad, that would not be as humble as we might be, because these stories have developed over so many generations into something independent, into something independent from what archaeologists can prove and people will believe. So there are two truths in a way. There is the truth that archaeologists might find and say, well, maybe, you know, there was only a small, a very small empire by which somebody called King David ruled, or there was that big empire which the Bible describes, and that's what most people believe. So I think there is the truth of the archaeologists, and there is the truth of the of those who believe in the biblical account, and that's okay. I can live with that. We just should be aware of it.
As this episode attests, and as the others will as well, and as I will attest from having lived there for a few years, Jerusalem is a city with problems. Those are not new to the city, and they will continue to exist as they have existed. My question here is on the modern city of Jerusalem, a city of nearly a million people, just over 60% Jewish, just under 40% Arab, fairly large, sprawling city, versus the biblical city of Jerusalem. How similar are they? And how have people tried to take biblical Jerusalem and turn it into modern Jerusalem for a narrative or for a story or for a purpose?
Well, I've lived in Jerusalem as well for a few years. And let me say this, and that may come, you know, a little bit of anticlimax to the series, but I think, yes, Jerusalem embodies the conflict, no doubt, for the world, for the politicians, and I agree, much of history has also been exploited. But don't forget one thing, and that may not make for a TV series, but don't forget that for the people living there, and for the people, not just today, who've lived there for centuries, it is their city. It is a city where their kids go to school, where they want the trash collected, and where they support their respective sports teams. So I think that's something we always should keep in mind. It's actually a city, yes, there was a lot of conflict in that city. But don't forget, it's also a city like every other city, where people help each other out, where they also get along and where they work together. And I think that's something which struck me when I lived there, and probably you too, Oren, that it's not all about conflict. It's also a city where people live and have their daily issues like in any other city, with maybe a lot of burden of history, that is true, but with the everyday problems every other person has in another city of the world.
Professor Mourad, your perspective on biblical Jerusalem versus the modern municipality of Jerusalem.
That's great perspective because, yeah, essentially we fall ourselves. We can fall victims to our own idealization. What we are looking for sometimes becomes an obstacle in the way we look at Jerusalem today, and we search for it for specific things. And you know, there's something that gave rise in the modern Jerusalem, something we call the Jerusalem syndrome, is when people go to Jerusalem expecting it to look like biblical Jerusalem. And they start having psychological crises when the city doesn't look like it is biblical Jerusalem. People there don't seem to be at all aware of the biblical Jerusalem. So sometimes our idealization of the city can trump that reality that exists today, where borders are much more permeable than sometimes we think, if we only want to take the issue of the animosity and the conflict as the only factor that governed the relationship, especially between Israelis and Arabs, when actually the situation is much, much more complex than that. And there is lots of coexistence, lots of conversations that are happening. So the biblical city also exists in our mind to a large extent, exists in our lore, exists in our legends, also exists in our desires, exists somehow in our identity, if one wants to think that history also shapes identity. But the current city of Jerusalem is also creating its own dynamic relationship about identity, about relationship, about its own lore. So there is biblical Jerusalem, there is Byzantine Jerusalem, there is early Islamic Jerusalem, there is Crusader Jerusalem, there is Mamluk Jerusalem. And these cities happen to be in the same geography, except each one was able to create something. And when we talk about Jerusalem, it's all of these combined. And the modern Jerusalem is creating its own narrative. What ultimately would be that narrative is still to be seen, because whether you're talking about Israeli society or Palestinian society, there is division about the fate of Jerusalem and whether we can share it or we don't need to share it. So there is something still to be seen about the ultimate status of the modern city of Jerusalem. But here you have it. It's not one city, but it can be one in our illusions.
As you just pointed out, it is city built upon city over the generations and the ages. It is religion built upon religion as well. Islam borrowed from Christianity and Judaism. Christianity borrowed from Judaism. Judaism borrowed from the polytheistic religions before that in the area. Have those changes and evolutions helped the city of Jerusalem or hurt? And has it helped the people of Jerusalem or hurt? Your perspectives, Professor Brenner.
You know, I'm a historian and I love history, but sometimes in some places you might think there's a little bit too much of history, and Jerusalem definitely is the place where you would think so. Maybe, you know, if you would look a little bit less to the past and more to the future that might help people get along and the city in the future. Of course, that's an illusion. And again, history is important, and I love the city. I love all the layers, and I very much like what Professor Mourad said. It's not a city, it's many cities, it's many layers, and literally it's many layers, because if you, if archaeologists go further down a layer, you're in the Roman city, you go further down, you're in the biblical city, and so on. And you see all of that. And I think when people come for the first time to Jerusalem, they are stunned how close together the holy places of the three religions are. And I'm thinking, of course, of, you know, the holy, the remnant of the Second Temple, the Western Wall, and the Dome of the Rock, and the Al-Aqsa Mosque built right upon it, and also the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And all of those are, you know, basically next to each other. So I think there is a wrong idea that the fact that those religions are so close together, and not just in terms of the space in Jerusalem, but also in terms of much of what they say and their development, that, you know, why can't we get along better? We're so close to each other. But I think it's that closeness, and you see it in Jerusalem. It's the closer you are, the more tension you have. It's often like in families, right? And, you know, Jews and Hindus or Christians and Buddhists didn't have much conflicts, and I may be exaggerating a little bit, but the closer the religions are, the more they fight about the right interpretation. And it's the closeness that creates tension. Sometimes we forget that. And it's even more if you go to the holiest Christian place, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. It's the different Christian denominations that fight against each other. It's not just Christians, Jews, and Muslims. And you have, of course, different denominations, other religions as well. So it is quite complex. And sometimes I think, you know, a little bit history, a little bit less of history wouldn't hurt a place like Jerusalem. It has more than enough of it.
Professor Mourad?
Yes, I agree a lot with that point of view. I would add that we need also to take into consideration the complexity within Judaism, within Christianity, and within Islam, and to add some nuance in the sense that further pick up on what Professor Brenner said and take it a little bit further, is that they are not only close to each other and share a lot of the same myth of origin, but they worship the same God. And each community wants to prove to that God they are better. So it's very much like they are three siblings looking at the parents, and they are competing of who to get more attention from the parent and more love from the parent. That sometimes actually, even though it's so simplistic, but can explain a lot of what goes on in that kind of competition. Historically, Jews, Muslims, and Christians were not always in a constant kind of clash. This idea of a predetermined or unavoidable clash is a modern political construct. In pre-modern times, they fought among each other, and they fought each other, but also they coexisted. So what applies to the relationship between themselves also applies to the relationship among themselves. And Professor Brenner said it very aptly. It's very much like the relationship within a family. There is a lot of animosity, but doesn't mean that families can only resolve their problems through bloodshed. Sometimes it happens, sometimes it doesn't. More often, it doesn't. And that's the history of the three religious traditions. The fact that they, you know, you look at Jerusalem, up till the modern time, and here we probably need to take the factor of the British rule in Jerusalem after the First World War as adding the kind of political catalyst that created dynamics where Palestinians and Israelis started to look at each other as hard to coexist rather than natural to coexist, even though on the ground they still coexist to a large extent. before that, you know, you look up till 1917, the majority of the population in Jerusalem, even though it has been under Muslim control for 1400 years, the majority of the population of Jerusalem was Christian. And then there was significant Jewish presence there. What this means is that even though the Muslims were in control politically, they didn't move to eliminate the others or destroy the religious spaces. So does that tell us something? It tells us that actually they saw more in common and more ability to share than the urge to fight over it, even though at some point they did fight over it.
I'll wrap up here with a two-part question. One is a question purely of opinion. There is no wrong answer. And then just an open-ended question to be interpreted however you'd like to interpret it. First, when you look at the history of Jerusalem, a few thousand years here, is there one leader you look at and say, this is the greatest leader in the history of Jerusalem? And then the open-ended question, does Jerusalem have a solution? Is there a solution to Jerusalem, whatever that means to you, Professor Brenner?
Look, I don't think I look into a leader. I think if there is a leader, it is a collective. It's the people of Jerusalem who have gone through different rules over the century, through a lot of oppression, but also expressed their will to survive, to live on, and to build not just a museum, and I think that's very important to state, but a real city over and over again. So for me, the real hero, the people of Jerusalem, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, all together. And in terms of a solution, well, you know, I wish I wouldn't sit here, I think. That's, of course, something which a lot of politicians have tried to discuss over the last decades. And I would think there is. I would think there is. I don't think it is today or tomorrow, but I think and we saw that in some of the more recent peace discussions, for example, in Camp David and Taba around 2000, that there were plans to make the city livable and make it for everyone there and make it also part of, that was the idea back then, a two-state solution, be it a two-state or one-state, so whatever will be the solution in the future, Jerusalem has to be shared. And I want to say one thing, it is also a city which, you know, people can access today. We shouldn't forget that people of different faiths live there. Before 1967, for example, between 1948 and 67, Jews were not allowed to enter under Jordanian rule. People live there, not without conflict, but sometimes I'm more surprised that there is not more conflict, not more bloodshed. Take many other places where you have much more bloodshed. So there is not an ideal solution now. I hope there will be an even better one. But it is a city today where every member of every religion can worship in their own way.
Professor Mourad, do you have somebody you look at as the greatest leader in the history of this incredible city? And your perspective, is there a solution here to Jerusalem?
I agree that I personally don't like leaders, and I won't name any leader. But I like that very much, and I would have thought similarly that we need to acknowledge the resilience of the people of Jerusalem, who, despite tremendous, and I don't necessarily say problems among themselves, monotheists, but those who created the idea of Jerusalem as a holy city, and they were so resilient that they said, essentially, there is nothing in terms of persecution, killing, extermination, that's going to take it away from us. And this is essentially the history of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam in relationship to the city of Jerusalem. It doesn't matter how much problems the people faced, they still insisted on living in the city, and they still insisted on having the city live in them. And that is remarkable. So instead of actually nodding for leaders, let's nod the people who make those leaders. In terms of solution, I think we need to learn a lot from history, from the good history. Again, history can inspire us to do bad things, and history can inspire us to do good things. So let's look at the kind of constructive history, and look at Jerusalem as a trust, where we as humans, especially as Muslim Christians and Jews, we are custodians. We are not owners of this place. We are custodians. And I don't necessarily say it as a believing person myself, but we should look at certain cities from the perspective of custodianship. That is, we are here to take care of those cities and make them open for everybody, and try to reduce the political hegemony that sometimes can impose itself on the way the city is lived and the city experienced by its own people. But also I need to add that, unfortunately, in the last at least 20 years, the political situation has not helped thinking constructively of a solution for Jerusalem. There was euphoria around the Oslo Agreement of possibly finding a solution for the Israeli-Palestinian problem, and definitely for Jerusalem. But we have passed that, and now we have went through a very problematic period where the two sides don't talk to each other, and definitely there is no serious conversation about Jerusalem and its fate. We need to hopefully have the momentum change that puts in place a kind of ability for the partners to sit back on the table with a broker who is really honest in finding a solution. Because if we don't have that kind of political climate, there is no way we can. You know, we can wish there is going to be a solution for Jerusalem, but that is absolutely unrealistic. But for me, the key issue here is we need to approach the question of Jerusalem from the perspective of custodianship. Custodianship in the terms of how we can keep the city open, on the one hand, for two political nationalisms, that is Israel and Palestine, and at the same time, how we can keep the city open for Christians, Jews, and Muslims. And not say that this is area is for the Jews, and this area is for the Muslims, and this this area is for the Christian. Because essentially, to give you some examples, and sorry, I'm taking a little bit more time, to give you some example from the Middle Ages, there were times when Christians, Jews, and Muslims converged on the Temple Mount to worship, not necessarily together, but in the same space. This is not possible today, given the political context. And Jerusalem is the kind of city where you should expect people to converge to the same place with the expectation that they are going to worship and be respected in the way and allowed to do their worship in the same space, even though if they are not necessarily doing it together. So we need the political climate that can help us achieve those things. But the key, again, is the notion of custodianship, in my opinion.
Professors Mourad and Brenner, shukran. Dankeschön, Toda, thank you for this wonderful conversation that built a little bit on the first episode of Jerusalem, City of Faith and Fury. There are six episodes that will begin airing this Sunday, and I have to get this right, on CNN, July 18th at 10 p.m. So please feel free to tune in. We have a hashtag for it, hashtag Jerusalem Series, to join the conversation on social media. Thank you. We hope you learned a tremendous amount about what is a very special city. And as I've often told all of the visitors I was lucky enough to have over the years, it doesn't matter if you believe one of the faiths, all three of the faiths, none of the faiths, it's a wonderful place to visit and to appreciate the impact and the power it has, not only on those people around you, but that it has had on thousands of years of human history. We hope you'll join us then. Thank you, everyone, and have a good night.
Thank you.